Next weekend is Resurrection Day, and we're celebrating resurrection. The problem with resurrection, and as I mentioned, and as I need to kind of slide into this preaching moment, is the fact that before there can be a resurrection, there's got to be a crucifixion. And so my assignment today is to adequately and appropriately get Jesus dignified in the best way we can, but we walk through together this morning the crucifixion. But something really significant. In most of us, as we sit in church year after year, Sunday after Sunday, we watch the preacher preach and we say to ourselves, I could do that. Or, I've got some words I'd love to say. Well, whether you like it or not, or whether you know it or not, you continually are preaching a life sermon. Do you know that, in my opinion, the greatest sermon Jesus ever preached was not the Sermon on the Mount, was not the times he gathered the believers together around a dinner. It was his crucifixion moment. And I don't know that I've ever taken and walked through that day of his crucifixion and realized what a phenomenal sermon he preached that day. I remember the great statement that Charles Spurgeon said about his own preaching. He says, I'm preaching to dying men as a dying man. You see, what if this was the last sermon I ever preached to you? Would I treat it any differently than I might otherwise? I hope not. I hope not, because there are moments in time that we look at our own frailty of life and we realize this could really be my moment in time. But this morning, what I want to do is to share with you Jesus' sermon that he preached from the cross. He made some words there. I enjoy expanding on the words that Jesus spoke from the cross. And he spoke seven words, seven utterances, seven different statements he made on the cross. We'll touch on them a little bit as we go through our lives. But yet there is a word, and I always like it when Dennis says the same things I'm going to say. For instance, he said that the Lord laid on his heart the verse in Psalms 19. Well, it's in my notes to share, Dennis, that the psalmist says, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O God. Let the words of my mouth. I want to take it another direction this morning and say, what about the behavior of our lives? What about how we live our lives? What about the decisions, the process of making decisions? What are those saying to those around about us? I'm not preaching behavioralism. I'm preaching actions. Speaking louder than words. And the greatest sermon you will ever preach is the life you live. The greatest sermon you'll ever preach is the example you leave to others to follow. This morning, we bring Jesus to that place again. I want to read some verses to you in Luke chapter 23. And I want to just begin reading. I can't read the whole story. The whole story of the crucifixion is told clearly in all four Gospels. And the writers of those books, they all take a little different angle of what happened on the cross that day. Some of them highlight this statement he made. Another one highlights this statement he made. Consistently through it all is a lifestyle that we really admire and need to emulate from his conduct and his behavior. For instance, during his trial and in the accusations laid on him, the scripture says he was accused and he was mocked, and yet he answered not a word in his own defense. He didn't blame his place in life on those around about him. He owned who he was. He owned why he was there. And it was him who had said that no man's going to ever take my life from me. I'm going to give it up freely. And he walked that through so exactly on that day. I'm reading out of the book of Luke this year, out of the 23rd chapter of Luke, beginning in verse 26. When they led him away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, coming in from the country, and placed on him the cross to carry behind Jesus. And following him was a large crowd of people and of women who were mourning and lamenting. But Jesus turned to them. Now listen, here's where he begins his sermon. Jesus is being led to Calvary. Jesus is being led to his death. And in compassion, he turns and sees the crowds following him, and he says, "Daughters of Jerusalem, stop weeping for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For behold, the days are coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren and the womb who has never borne and the breast who have never nursed.' Then they began to say, to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do these things when the tree is green, what will happen when it is dry? Two others also, who were criminals, were being led to be put to death with him. And when he came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right and the other on the left. And Jesus was saying, 'Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing.' And they cast lots, dividing up his garments among themselves." A picture that kind of is elaborated by many around about the cross that day. But I just want you to get this picture. I'll be back to this in a moment. Ouch. I want you to get this picture. Jesus has been tried, falsely accused, convicted, worthy of death, and was being led to the place called the Hill of the Skull, or Golgotha. And I've been there. I marched up that hill. It was called the Hill of the Skull because if you ever saw a picture of that rock, you would see as if a couple eyes and a nose and a mouth were all carved out of that rock. It was just the formation of the rock. But it had the name, the place of the skull, not because Jesus was crucified there. It was already named that. He was just crucified there. But as he was on his way, being led through the city to the outskirts of town, someone was called to carry his cross. There's a sermon, folks. There's a sermon. Because one of the great texts of the scripture that I love is when Paul in Galatians says, "I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." We have all been called to be crucified with Christ, to pick up that cross and carry it for him through life's experiences together. And then as he was going through the city, he noticed that a large crowd was gathering behind him. And they were mourning and they were lamenting. And I don't know what the conversations were back there, but I'm sure there was a lot of sadness, a lot of sorrow, and a lot of pain being experienced. For the innocent followers of Jesus were following the innocent man who was being crucified wrongly. Wrongly in the eyes of their understanding. And remember this, that it wasn't yet in their experiences that the disciples really got it. They got it about at the resurrection. They're going to get it next week. This week they're confused. This week they're hiding. This week they're not as dominant as they're supposed to be. But Jesus, seeing the crowd behind him, turns to them. And he says, no, no, don't weep for me. Weep for yourselves. Weep for your children. Weep for your society. Weep for your culture. And then he was carried on. The day began for Jesus about 9 o'clock in the morning when they first took him to Calvary. Ended about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. 6 hours of agony and pain. During those hours, the greatest sermon he ever preached, a sermon that each one of us must preach. Without going to all the words that Jesus spoke, I only share with you some thoughts about it. And that was this. Prominent in that message he preached that day was a message of forgiveness. That message has never changed. The gospel is fundamentally built on the forgiving power of the Lord Jesus Christ. The message is one of forgiveness. Now, but let's preach that message. Let's preach that message to each other. Let's preach that message to those who offend us. Let's preach that message to those who have not offended us, but we know are offensive and need to be forgiven and need to be brought into a place of grace and mercy. Jesus looked at those people handling or mishandling him. And he said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. The New American Standard, the King James says, and Jesus said. The New American Standard says, Jesus was saying. A study of the original Greek language at that point is a statement that says, Jesus continually said. Jesus was saying over and over and over again, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. With each new offense on that day, he would say, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. What was he saying with this issue of forgiveness? Not just to block it out, not just to forget it ever happened, but Father, don't hold this sin to their charge until they understand. There's forgiveness. There's the heart of Jesus. Because you see, now the theological mind, much greater than mine could ever be, was suggesting that it would have been theologically possible that as they abused Jesus, the wrath of God could come from heaven and abuse them. And Jesus was saying, don't. Don't hold this against them because they don't understand. I don't know how exactly accurate that is other than going through life being a forgiver. The greatest message we'll ever preach by our lifestyle is one of forgiveness. as he kept saying, "Father, forgive them." The reason I chose the text in Luke this year is because the second message, and it's just a word, and either all of these are just words of the message, was built around the story that says on this occasion that there were two other people that was crucified with him that day. He was not crucified alone. There were two criminals that were crucified that day for their sins. And as they were all on the crosses, their crosses, one on his right, one on his left, one of the criminals began saying, I don't like this situation much. Jesus, if you are who you say you are, why don't you prove your power to come down off the cross and then get us off the cross and let's get out of here. That's what one of the criminals was saying. The other criminal responded to the first criminal and says, "What are you talking about? We're here because we deserve to be here. We're here because of the guilty plea or conviction against us for the deeds of our lives. But this man has done nothing wrong." Jesus looks at that man and he says a promise. And this is the promise. "You've made a great declaration. Today you will be with me in paradise." Do you hear what he said to that man? That criminal? The man who was rightly judged and condemned? "Today you will be with me in paradise." He was saying, first of all, today you're going to die. And you're going to die rightly for the sins you've committed. But remember that after death there is a life again to come. And you'll be with me because I'm going to die today also. The second word of that message that Jesus preached that day was a promise. A promise that he kept. A promise that literally goes through the entire scriptures as we know it. It is filled with the promises he gave us. It's filled with the encouragement about us and around about us. But it was Jesus who promised, "I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. And everywhere you go, I will be there to sustain you, to guide you, to lead you, to help you along the way." And by the way, with my strength, you can do whatever it is I've called you to do with your life. Promise after promise after promise. Promises of health, promises of prosperity, promises of healing, promises of understanding, promises of good wisdom along past the way path. God has a great message of promise. But now listen, if Jesus promises us to be with us every day of our lives, is that a promise we can make to each other? It needs to be. But you see, we are a people of unclean lips. We are a people of unreliable promises. And the message we preach must be understood as truthful and honest and dependable because it's a promise. And listen, a man's word still needs to be his bond. And the message we preach is the message of promise. Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. And he promised, "Call upon the name of the Lord and you will be saved." A promise. Thirdly, I appreciate this quality. Jesus was a man of Well, Jesus was a man. There was the man quality of Jesus. And as this man, he was a man of emotion and a man of feeling. He was so in tune with his own feeling that just a couple days earlier in the Garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus took his disciples for a last time of praying together, he was talking to the Father on one of his trips away from the disciples to pray. And he says, "Father, if there's another way to get this job done, I think I'd like to choose it." Now, he didn't put it quite that way. I put it the way I would have made it a lot less tougher than that. I said, "Please, God, help me out of this thing," because he knew what was coming. He says, "Father, if it be your will, let this cup pass from me. But nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." On the cross, he makes the statement, emotional feeling statement, "I'm thirsty." He was a man. He was thirsty. He made another feeling statement that says, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Do you realize he felt that way? There's even a strong case that can be made for the reality of the feeling that God turned his back on Jesus for a moment that he might bless him for eternity. That God turns his back on sin for a moment that he might bring us to a place of redemption, that forever his face might be on us. You see, his statement that afternoon, my God, why hast thou forsaken me," was not even an original statement of his. That was not original with him. You know who it was original with? David. David the psalmist said, and look it up, Psalms 22:1. Look it up. It says, quote, my God, why have you forsaken me?" The psalmist said that 2,000 years before Jesus quoted on the cross. But it was a feeling statement that he understood. Here's my encouragement to you. There was an open vulnerability that Jesus expressed that day. The same vulnerable emotional expression they expressed in the Garden of Gethsemane. I appreciate the fact that something Jolene said this morning while she was just leading you in worship. Nice for me to hear this from her. She says, "I'm not perfect." I had figured that out. But you see, do you realize what that's about? I recognize myself, and I'm trusting myself in my relationship with you to know that I am not perfect and it can still be okay between you and me. That's what it means. So suddenly we look at each other and we say, "Yeah, I know you've had a tough life. Yeah, I know you have a background. Yeah, I know you have some history that you're not even proud of yourself. I know all that." But does any of that need to stand between a relationship that God needs to build between us? No, never. Why? Because we've already declared ourselves understanding the message of forgiveness, understand the message of hope, of presence, and then a message of, okay, I understand, and I know you understand that we are all men of the world, Matter of fact, I often go back to Psalms 22 because it's really about the cross. The whole chapter, read the whole chapter. It's an interesting chapter about the cross. Psalms 22, about the cross. He talks about his bones being out of joint, but not one broken. He talks about his clothes being cast lots for. And then in the middle of it, he says, you know, I'm nothing more right now than a worm of the earth. Totally giving himself up of any value. Why? For the sake of others. For the sake of you and for the sake of me. Fourthly, there's a message in this. And it's an important message that we have been talking about and we'll be talking about more in the days to come. And I'm just going to use the word caring. A message of human caring. A message of emotional and spiritual caring for each other. Jesus is on the cross, surveying what's below him through bloody eyes, teary eyes, foggy feelings, impending death. And he sees a disciple there, one of the few, maybe only ones there that day. The Apostle John, the disciple John. And he looks over here and he sees his mother. And he says, John, behold your mother. John, this now is to be your mother. John, you're to take my place as her son. Catch this. Jesus was caring for his mother. Now, historically, if you know the story, you know that his father had already died years before. And so Mary, at the death of Jesus, was a widow. Except Jesus, in his caring departure, assigned John to oversee the care of his mother. This might sound so simple. Except, church, we've got to learn how to care for each other. I don't ever want the statement, we are family, to become so trite that it loses its meaning. Because you are our family. Jolie and I made that commitment to you years ago that we are the family. We care about that. John's role was then to become a substitute. But do you realize something about Jesus that day? He was already substituting. Before he was taken to the cross to be crucified, they were prepared to make a trade. And they brought out before Pilate Barabbas. Now, if you know the story of Barabbas, Barabbas was a maniac. He was a criminal. And I love the way he's always portrayed in Jesus movies. He looks like a maniac in the movies. I think, yeah, they've got him picked up really well. He was a mean, cruel, ugly man who was arrested and in the custody of the law. And they brought him out to the people that day, knowing that the people would say, no, he needs to be crucified. Release our king to us. That's what Pilate was hoping to have done. He didn't want to crucify Jesus. But the people started saying, which do you want? Release unto us Barabbas. Release unto us Barabbas. Release unto us Barabbas. And suddenly, for Barabbas' sin, Jesus took his place that day. You realize the depth of that? Jesus already declared himself a substitute. Jesus theologically already said that if he went to the cross and died for us, he would go there in our place. Because who of us are not worthy of dying for our sins and paying the penalty for our own sins? But you see, here's the message of Barabbas. It doesn't matter if you are a maniac in sin. Jesus will take your place. It doesn't matter how cruel you are, Jesus will take your place. It doesn't matter how lost and unkept you are or what a wild background you've had. None of that matters. Jesus says, I'm going to take your place. And then Jesus says to John, John, I want you to take my place taking care of my mother. John was a substitute for the substitute, for which we are now called to be a substitute for. Do you realize you are the only Jesus some people hear about? Your experience, your faith, your life? That Christianity is pictured in some people's minds by what they see and hear from you, literally and personally. And there are some people who have been just ushered into the kingdom because of the words you spoke. And unfortunately, there are people who've been hindered from even coming to Christianity because of what they see in the lives of Christians. We need to own both of those. And we need to be willing to become a caring people who are willing to substitute for the substitute in this world we live in. And then at the end, Jesus makes two other statements that I want to just conclude with very quickly. Another word for the message you preach, the sermon you will preach with your life, is a sermon of prayerfulness. Jesus says, Father, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. Father, I'm coming home. It was a prayer. And we don't always know the order in which these statements are made. Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. He prayed that prayer. And then he said, it is finished. Have you ever wondered what was finished that day? The agony that he lived in that whole week? No. The stripes on his back? No. The misunderstanding, the scourging, the false accusations? None of that. No. Redemption was finished. The only reason he was there was to substitute for you being there. He kept his promise. I am free because he was bound. I am forgiven because he was guilty. I'm loved because he was hated. You get the picture? Jesus concluded that day, and boy, listen, I could preach a year on that afternoon. I'm not kidding you. The phenomenal, miraculous things that happened that day is almost unbelievable in our eyes. But this is enough for us to do today. Today, we see Jesus crucified. But next Sunday is a new day. I'm looking forward to next Sunday. And matter of fact, you need to be aware, we've really tried to change our normal procedure for Easter Sunday way around for next Sunday. And you will enjoy what Jolene and what Roy have prepared for you with the kids for next Sunday. It'll just be a good day. But remember this. Sometimes we go through life with tough days. But tomorrow's always a new day. It's a day of forgiveness, a day of promise, a day of hope, a day of caring for one another, a day of knowing that Jesus himself took our place. The rhetorical question is often asked, if you were the only person left on earth unredeemed, and Jesus came as he did, would he still have done for you individually and personally and only what he ultimately did for the whole world? Everybody agrees, theologians agreed in time that yes, he would have still done the same thing because we have a Heavenly Father who loves us. Do you realize what he suffered for us? I brought one of my souvenirs to you this morning. Some of you have seen this before. Some of you haven't. This is the crown of thorns that Jesus wore. Now, not the exact same one, because I wasn't there. But listen, I picked this branch in Israel, sitting on a travel bus. I pulled the leaves off, formulated it like it is today. This right here is still as sharp as it was, maybe even sharper, 25 years ago. We were traveling to the Dead Sea. We stopped at a hamburger joint for lunch. Alongside the parking lot was a row of bushes. And I don't know particularly why, but I went over and looked at the bushes, and here was this tree. One of the people that was working in the yard said, "That's the same bush that Jesus' crown of thorns was made out of." I couldn't resist picking it. I picked it, I made the thorns, and then I realized later that it wouldn't have mattered because you're not allowed to take anything like this raw material out of the country. Being in my imperfect self, I said, "Oh yeah, watch me." I built a box, a little cardboard box that this fit in. I never checked it when we left the country. I carried it on my lap in my own hands, clear from that afternoon having a hamburger to home. It's been a decorative thing in Jolene's office for a lot of years. The point is this: does this give you any idea of what he endured for you as your substitute? How would you like to have worn this? You are worthy to have worn it. You earned the right to wear it, but you weren't required to, because he said, "I'll do it for you." And then he says to us today, okay, the world needs to hear this message. You are to substitute for me, to take the message. You're there to carry my message for me after I'm gone. Church, get ready. Get ready. We have spent the better part of this year waiting on the Lord for a sense of refocusing what it is we do and why we do it. We have some direction for this coming year and for our futures here. And you've heard of it. You've heard it already today. You'll hear it continually. We need to make an impact in our community. We need to make an impact where you work. We need to make an impact in your family. We need to substitute for Jesus everywhere we are and change the world as if he were there doing it in our place. You okay with that?
Amen.
Are you ready to get on board?
Yes.
All right. Stand with me, will you? Yeah. As far as I know, yes. Now, you're the man to say it.
Okay.
You're the man to say it.
Yeah, I just want to make sure, because I told him Wednesday I wasn't sure.
Okay. Well, okay, now listen, let me make another statement. How many of you really appreciate what Dennis is doing, carrying the load of teaching in our congregation right now? Beginning on Monday night at, 6:30. It was originally designed for fathers and boys, and it's kind of grown to encourage all of you men. Is that a fair statement to say? Okay. If you haven't been to a Monday night Bible study yet, men, show up. And the regular Wednesday night Bible study right here, Dennis teaches that, and that's cool. Every Easter, we have the whole platform here lined with Easter lilies, and they're always beautiful. And what we do is we buy Easter lilies. You just put your name out there. You can buy them in memory of someone who has passed on and experienced resurrection. Some saint of yours, some loved one of yours, will put their name on it, and we'll have it up here for you next Sunday. And then after the service on next Sunday, you can take it home with you and plant it in your garden. And it's kind of interesting. If you forget and take it home, I take them home. And I've got lilies coming up everywhere in our backyard because I took yours home. And that's okay. All right, let's pray. I hope I didn't keep you too long this morning. Are you okay with today?
Yes.
Okay, let's pray. Lord, in this world, we just want to take your place. We want to be your voice. We want to be your hands of mercy. We want to be your example of righteousness. We want to be your words of wisdom, words filled with grace and mercy. And I ask, Lord, that you would continually empower us, gift us to understand our place and our time. Open doors that we've never dreamed of before, that we might faithfully serve you. Dismiss us to a time of fellowship now, we pray, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you for being here this morning. Blessings on you. See you back before long.